how the muscles relate to one another and how they react on an individual. Each client can be viewed as a unique puzzle, and through a comprehensive
understanding. Goes back with her arms, she'll break it. If she goes forward, she'll break it. Bring your arms next to you. And when she goes into the anterior pelvic tilt, she actually does that with her lumbar spine. Back. So the glenohumeral joint, which is the shoulder joint, is made up of the humerus and the glenoid cavity, which is a little cavity over here, which is actually part of the scapula. And this area here we call the ischial tuberosities. One more for me, and adduct them in towards each other, and then gently abduct them and pulling them away. And we pull out a whole bunch of muscle fibers with it, and that forms a group of muscle fibers, or we can call it a fascicle or a fasciculus. So if you think about a basic pelvic curl that you've learned, and you getting a new client to do a basic pelvic curl, and they're actually able to do it, and you see, wow, I actually think this client has a really good mind-body connection, and I think that they're also quite strong. So she's trying to stretch the fibers there already. Then get that deep neck retraction with longus capitis and longus colli. Gently take your head over to the right-hand side, keeping that chin in. And this is important. This elbow is at a 30-degree angle because that's your scapular line. Muscles can be named by where they are situated, their relative position. So if I say to you that this is you looking at the back of the scapula, here is your collarbone or your clavicle, and here is your chest. If I say subscapularis, it means that this muscle has to be under sub the scapula, subscapularis. This muscle is going to lie underneath, and it's going to come across, and it's going to lift your arm for me, Lamise, attach to the actual front of the upper humerus. Take it out again for me, Lamise. Scapula does that, and then subscapularis brings it back. Let's do it, sir. And a bursa is a fluid-filled sac that lies between the muscle and the bone. And that bursa is there to prevent friction. And when we constantly pressing up against the humerus to the actual scapula, where we make that space shorter or smaller, we start irritating that bursa and it actually becomes inflamed. Now, who do I think would really need a good latissimus dorsi? And we're not talking about people that just want to tone it and don't want the flesh over there. We're talking about specific sports people. Forwards. And because they've actually traveled forward, she's gone into an anterior pelvic tilt. Sorry, I'm just sticking that in there. Perfect. Now, when we have a look at this position, when you go and look at all kinds of studies on the psoas, that's going to tell you that there's probably a little bit of psoas major activation in there as well, or slight shortening with iliacus and all of the other hip flexors. If she drops into a posterior pelvic tilt, there we go, there's a section of the psoas called psoas minor, and a lot of single leg raise, that straight leg raise on the bed. We said, yes, absolutely the psoas is working on the leg that's lifting, but strange, those tests showed that the psoas was also working on the side of the leg that was not lifting. As Lamise peels her spine up, I start stretching rec fem there, and now it gets a double stretch, which is why a tight rectus femoris often restricts somebody's ability to be able to do that diagonal line and get that pubic symphysis tucking through in a pelvic curl. But when I am an anterior tilter and I stick my bum out, I favor TFL, and this glute med becomes inhibited in its function as a hip stabilizer. To bend her legs, again being aware of whether this client can actually even lie prone according to their hip flexor flexibility, abdominal space, big thighs, big muscles. Bring your knees inwards, and this is often how they actually test whether that piriformis is really tight, is you just want them to pull through a little bit there. There we go. And then they gently flop their knees open. Breathe. But because adductor magnus is such a big muscle, it actually has anterior, and posterior fibers, and then obviously medius, but anterior and posterior fibers. And therefore, it also does hip extension. So if Lamise goes up now, her adductor magnus is working quite a bit. And if I give her this ball, that's going to be one of the most effective adductor magnus exercises. Back here and forward there. Almost like they want to tuck their pelvis slightly and fully extend that knee. And if you have any problems, you are welcome to pop us an email and we can definitely help you with that. But I'm sure you'll be able to do it.